blessed us and brought us from a long way. And as I look around in the building tonight, I see a lot of faces that was here the very first time we came to Memphis and sang this song that we're about to sing. If you remember this song, we want you to let us know. Dwayne?
Searching for a long time. I knew
We are to be here once again and to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. The Lord is in his holy temple, and all the earth keeps silent before him. Amen. I'm just delighted and excited to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Let's stand on our feet as our music ministry leads us in the opening number.
Thank you, Lord, I thank you for this journey. Lord, you brought me from a mighty long way, a mighty long way. Lord, I thank you, Lord, I thank you for this journey. Lord, you brought me from a mighty long way. Church, can y'all hear me sing it? Say, Lord, I thank you for this journey. Lord, you brought me from a mighty long way, a mighty long way. Lord, I thank you, Lord, I thank you for this journey. Lord, you brought me from a mighty
I'll sing a little bit for me, Keith. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you for this journey. Lord, you brought me from a mighty long way, mighty long way. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you for this journey. Lord, you brought me from a mighty long way.
What the matter with him? Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't it good to be born again? It's just great to know the Lord and to be on the Lord's side. Because when you're on the Lord's side, you're on the winning side. Amen. Hallelujah. Chosen to read from the book of Galatians, chapter 3, verses 1 through verse 14. Book of Galatians, chapter 3, verses 1 through verse 14. O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish? Having begun in the spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain? He therefore that ministered to you the spirit and working miracles among you, doth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. I need to pause right there. The word accounted means that it was put in his account. That's an accounting term. And it means where nothing was in his account, God put something in his account. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. Let me stop right there. Now, we were not born Jews, but by faith in Jesus, we have become the children of Abraham. So, what Paul is saying here, everything that God promised them has been given unto us. I've never been to Jerusalem. I've never been to Israel. Never been to Palestine. But all that God promised the Jewish nation has been deposited in our account. Amen. I know that's not what I normally do. I normally just read it and that's it, but I just couldn't help myself. So verse 8 says, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faith for Abraham. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Now, Paul takes his text from the book of Habakkuk. The book of Habakkuk talks about being justified by faith. Yeah. And that's where Paul gets this theme and this idea. Yeah. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. That the blessings of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. That's all of us here. That the blessings of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Amen. Amen. Excuse me for interjecting, but I couldn't help it. Amen.
grateful, Father. As we have assembled ourselves in thy sight, in thy presence, we stand. Father, we come acknowledging our shortcomings. Come acknowledging our souls. We acknowledge our sin. And oh, merciful Father, as the Holy Ghost come and minister unto us, it tells us what we need to do, and it will lead and guide us in that direction if we only submit unto it. Lord, in these days and time, we need you. Lord, we can't make it without you. We stand, Father, so much in fear for our children. Fear that Satan is rapidly overpowering us. But Father, if we just obey your spirit, because Lord, I know if you came to me, you have come to others. And Father, if you would just give us the mind to just pray to you. We don't have to say a lot of words. We don't even have to shout very loud. Well, you said in your word, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. And every tongue confess. And oh Lord, as we stand here in need, I call your name. I call you Jesus. Lord Jesus. My rock in a weary land. My shelter in a time of storm. Jesus, have mercy upon us. Jesus, help us to lift our hands. Help us, Father, to address all of these situations that's before us. Father, I pray in your name that you would help set us free, because we are the descendants of Abraham. Lord, I'm not claiming defeat, but I do claim victory, and I claim it in your name. Bless our pastor. Take him to a higher height and a deeper depth in your love. And then, Father, I pray that you would look on my brethren that sit in the seat of assistant Father Pastor. Lord, I call some of the names: Brother Reed, Harvey, Brother Wood, Brother Sin, Brother Thomas, and all the rest. I pray, Father, that you would embody us with power. Power to speak up. Power to acknowledge you of power to lead and guide the people that you have set us over. Bind us so close together. And I pray for the mothers. And I pray for the choir. And I pray for the musicians. Lord, I'm just asking that you bring us all together. Unite us with one mind and one determination and one spirit. Oh, please, I have mercy. And then, oh, merciful Father, I pray that you would lead us to a higher height and a deeper depth in your love. Jesus' mighty name, I pray.
Church can help us sing this. Let's form one big choir. Church, let me sing that one more time. I am grateful.
I am grateful
for the things that you have done.
Y'all sound good, church.
Yes, yes, I'm grateful for because I'm grateful, just to praise you, Lord. Flowing from my heart
are the issues
of my heart is gratefulness.
I know everybody know this part. Grateful. Let me hear you, church. Grateful. flowing, is flowing from my heart.
Grateful, 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 grateful,
is flowing from my heart. One more time, church.
Grateful, 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 gratefulness is flowing from my heart, flowing, flowing from my heart.
Are the issues of my heart?
Are the issues of my heart? His gratefulness.
Study Tuesday night, still on the book of Nehemiah. Amen. Serving God with determined faith. Amen. Is the theme. And we had a great time this past week. And we're looking forward with great anticipation this week. Amen. And we want you to come out and be with us. Amen. Maybe you can't make it every time, but you ought to make it sometime.
Amen.
Amen. I'm not meddling. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. Amen. You may not make it every time, but you should make it sometime. Amen. Amen. Now, we reminded you that on the first Sunday, we're going to be going to True Vine for their mortgage burning ceremony. And their worship starts at 11. And we're going to move ours to the 9 o'clock time. Amen. And that will put us past 10. And we will have adequate time to break and regroup and go and celebrate with them. Amen. And I want you all to write that down now, because somebody was calling Sister Rose trying to go this Sunday. Amen. Now don't go this Sunday. It's the first Sunday. The first Sunday, February. Amen. The first Sunday in February is when we are going to True Vine. Amen. And we had hoped that the choir would get their rehearsal in, and the weather was bad this week. And so we want you to try it again this week. You got 2 times to get there before first Sunday. And I plan to be with you this coming Wednesday. Amen. And you get on the phone, telephone, telegraph, tell everybody to be at choir rehearsal, that the pastor gonna be there. Amen. And we have relaunched our core ministries, and we want to relaunch our music ministry. dialogue so that we can move forward in the great things of God.
Amen.
The church is depending on you to do what you always have done, and that is praise our God. Amen. Amen. So it's not hard to do. And if you need some more microphone, just ask for what you need. Amen. If you need some, if you want some, if you feel better, if you had more, just say so. And the media will be sure that you have what you need.
Amen.
You have not because you ask not. Now, I told you the latter part of last year in December that the General Missionary Baptist State Convention, of whom we are affiliated with, was to receive and was proposed to receive, and that was a potential to receive, $750,000 from the Eli Lilly Endowment, pushed by the Mississippi Archives. And I'm here to report, as I reported to the Bible study, that endowment has come to pass. So our convention has received $750,000 from the Lilly Endowment to renovate and refurbish the chapel and the women's dormitory at Natchez College. Hear that, a great big round of applause. I have asked Brother Sims to put the press release on our Facebook page. So as soon as he gets it up, he gives me a thumbs up. It's already there. And there are some photographs that you can look at and see as well. I'm so excited over this project. And I'm doubly excited because when I looked at the photograph, there is a young man that's there from Indianola, and his cousin and I are good friends. The director of tourism is Roscoe Barnes III, and he is the director of tourism there in Natchez. And he is in the photo, and he was there to celebrate. In that photo, you're going to see Bennett Thompson. He was present, and some of our executives from the convention, along with our president, President Buckley. Amen. So we want you to take time to go to our Facebook page and see it, and rejoice in the wonderful things that God is doing in these last and evil days. God bless you, and God forever keep you, and let us keep hope alive. Amen. All right, ushers, come on and bless us.
I've been for the
Merciful Father, is in thy presence and in thy sight that we are thankful for this another opportunity to come into your house where you are praised and adored. Thank you, dear God, for your manifold blessings upon our lives. And Lord, when we fall short, we ask that you would forgive us and give us another chance to do better on this Christian journey. And we pray that any person here under the sound of my voice has not given their life over to you, we pray today that you would touch them, that they too might rejoice with all of us that know you in the pardoning of our sins. And by the grace that we have through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank you now for this preaching and teaching time. And we'll be careful to give you all of the praise and all of the glory. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. It's in Jesus' name we pray. That was sent by email, and if you saw it, she was smiling on the picture, and it gives us great hope, amen, and inspiration to keep on believing that God will heal her, amen. And we have heard from Brother Tate, and he has made great strides. Heard his voice and you. tell he is happy. I can see his teeth through the telephone. Amen. You know when somebody happy, don't you? You can just hear it in the voice, can't you? It just comes through, and we're grateful. But we want them to know, if they're listening, that we have never stopped praying on their behalf. Amen. And we believe that God will hear and answer prayer. Amen. I want to invite your attention to the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 1, verses 1 through verse 11. I decided I'd try to tackle this morning. Amen. When I say tackle it, I mean tackle it. Amen. Nehemiah chapter 1, verses 1 through verse 11. Old Testament, book of Nehemiah. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, and it came to pass in the month of Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass, and when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days, and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven, and said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night, for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee, both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments, which thou commanded thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out into the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather them from thence conquest of Nebuchadnezzar and the armies of Babylon and many of the Jews were captured and carried away as slaves. Daniel, Esther, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and of course, Nehemiah were the most prominent ones. They were in need of someone that knew the Lord and that could change their situation. God had such a man for such a time as this, and his name was Nehemiah. The life of Nehemiah is a life that shows us how to handle bad news and how to handle trouble when it comes. And how you can turn your vision into a reality. Now, today we do not have many men that are on the stage of history that are big on vision. Many people are dreaming shallow dreams and dreams that are small. But we serve a God that is big.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And he demands that people of faith dream big.
Yes, sir.
And have big visions for themselves.
Thank you, Lord.
For their family and friends.
That's right.
And for their nation. If you recall your history, there was a president by the name of Eisenhower who went on a trip to Germany, and he got on the Autobahn, and he had never been to Germany, and when he got on the Autobahn, he observed such breakneck speed that people travel. Matter of fact, back in that day, there was no speed limit. You could drive as fast as you wanted to. It was called the Autobahn. And when he got back to the United States as president, this made such a strong impression in his mind that he envisioned interstate highways all over the United States. And he used his power as president to influence Congress to provide the necessary funds to build highways all over this country. That you and I travel today from the north, the south, the east, and the west. It came into being because one man had a big vision.
All right. All right. Yeah.
So you see, having a dream and a vision means nothing until you can make it become a reality.
Amen. Amen.
The people of Jerusalem, they were in a terrible shape. And they needed someone that knew the Lord. And men came running to see Nehemiah, to tell them of their plight. When a problem comes, it demands people of vision. The first thing I want you to see in the text is the calmness of Nehemiah. He had a life as a cupbearer. He stood by the king. He tasted the wine. He tasted the food to be sure that there were no contaminants to poison the king. He had influence with the king. He had good retirement, company car,
all right,
company credit card, paid vacation, fringe benefits. Nehemiah had it made. But the difference in Nehemiah and many of us is he cared about his people. He cared about his people more so than all of the benefits that he had for himself. He took a chance. He took a risk because he had gotten some bad news from a faraway land. And he is the model that we need to take a look at this morning to remind ourselves, are we a people of vision? Are you a person of vision? Yes, we see the calamity that he faced when he visited. There was a visit from one of his brethren who brought bad news and a problem. The walls were down, which meant that invaders and enemies could easily get in. The gates were on fire. They were being humiliated. They felt defeated and hopeless. But we see his compassion. He displayed it by showing a broken heart. He fasted. He prayed. He confessed the sins of himself and the sins of his people. You know, whenever we confess our sin, God gets ready to do something. He gets ready to do something. When we confess that we have done wrong, when we have transgressed against God, God gets busy. When we set things right with him. When problems come and when bad news come, it demands an action plan. And that action plan is activated by prayer. You know, a lot of people get mixed up on what prayer is. All right. Prayer is just simply talking to God. Prayer is just simply talking to God.
Amen.
You see? Now, if God is the creator of the world, and you are talking to God, there's no need in you trying to find every big word you can find to say to him, because he made all the words in the vocabulary. So there's nothing you can do to impress him. Even if you got $10 million in the bank, that ain't nothing, because God owns everything. So there's nothing you can do to impress him. Nothing you can say, nothing you can present to him to impress him. So prayer is just simply talking to God. Talking to God. So the first line of defense is to talk to God about your situation. Whatever it may be, talk to God about your situation. Amen. He was a man of faith. Nehemiah was a man of faith, a man of prayer. He fell down on his knees. And I have found if you fall on your knees, you'll always be able to stand on your feet. Not only do we see his compassion, his love for his people. We as African Americans do not show love for our people. We will walk right by an enterprise where a brother or sister is struggling, trying to make a living. And go right next door and pull out all the money we got in our pocket. When they have more than they could ever spend. But if you really had love for your own people, you would patronize people that are efficient and people that can do the work. If you come to my house and you don't know what you're doing, I'm going to run you away. Because I don't want you.
All right.
But if you know what you're doing and you can do it efficiently and at a price that makes sense, I want your service. But we must have a love for our own, rather than hating one another. And I don't know why we are so jealous hearted and selfish that we don't want people that we come up with to rise. Y'all ain't listening to me. But if you really been born again, your heart shouldn't be like that. Why don't you say amen? You know, you shouldn't be so selfish and jealous hearted of your own people. Nehemiah, he had compassion for his own. In his situation, he had no reason for him to leave his position and to risk all that he had accomplished for his people, but he loved his people. And his people came to him and asked him for some help. Not only do we see his compassion, but we see the components of his prayer. The first component of the prayer is the same component that Jesus taught his disciples to start, "Our Father which art in heaven." He starts out in his prayer with praise. He starts praising God for his superiority, for his strength, for his sovereignty. He starts out praising God. And in praising God, you generally use adjectives. God, you're so good. You're so great. You're so gracious. You're so wonderful. You use adjectives to describe the greatness and the goodness of God. The prayer starts out with praise. Before you start with your list, I said before you start with your list of what you want from God, start out with praise. Thank him for what he's already done. Lord, if you don't do nothing else, you sure have done enough. And after you get through praising him, then God is ready to hear the rest of your story. Nehemiah had it right. He started out with praise. He started out with praise, praising God's superiority. That is, God is higher and bigger than anything that we can ever face.
Amen.
Started out with superiority, strength, his sovereignty, that nothing can stop God's plan. Nothing can keep God from accomplishing his will. You don't have to run to try to get ahead of the line. Because whatever God has for you is for you.
Yes, sir.
I said, whatever he has for you is for you.
Yeah.
If he got a special job, a special place, a special lot, a special house, or whatever it is, if he got it already set for you. You know, you can be at a car lot and there's one vehicle there that you got your heart set on. It may be five or six people watching that thing and want to buy it. But if God had it set for you, they can try to buy it and the credit won't go through.
Yeah.
Do y'all hear what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
I mean, if God really wants you to have it, if it's got your name on it, you don't have to worry and get in a hurry. God has it already set.
Got it set.
Do you hear me?
Yeah.
There have been many things that God has shown me.
Yeah.
That he revealed to me. Mm-hmm. That this is what I have marked out for you.
Yeah.
It's for Robert. Nobody else. But I don't have to get in a hurry. I don't have to hook and crook. I don't have to do anything illegal. All I have to do is stand still and see the salvation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I know I'm right about it.
Yeah.
I know I'm right about it. Yes. God is so good that he has everything marked out in advance.
Yeah.
Some years ago, I told Sister Kimball, I said, Sister Kimball, we're going to meet Felicia Richard. She said, oh, really? I said, yes. Well, Isaiah, we're going to meet Felicia Richard. Mm-hmm. You know Felicia Richard, don't you?
Yeah. Yeah.
On the Cosby's?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I have the picture at my house. And Mrs. Kimball is holding her hand.
Yes, sir.
She came to Greenville many years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. So, what am I saying to you? When God has things marked out for you.
Yeah.
It will happen. It will come to pass.
Yeah.
See not only his prayer, but see his perseverance.
Okay.
It's in verse 6. Yeah, it says that he prayed night and day.
Yes, sir.
You got to stick with it. I say you got to stick with it. If you believe it, you got to stick with it. He strayed with it until he got an answer.
Yeah.
Amen. He persevered. But not only do we see his prayer and his perseverance, but we see his penitence. That is, he asked God for forgiveness.
Yes, yes.
And God help anybody that don't ever ask God for forgiveness.
Yeah, yeah.
All of us,
yeah.
From the pulpit to the door,
yeah.
Have to ask God
for
forgiveness.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, somebody can just push the wrong button.
Yeah, no.
and you'll say the wrong thing. You don't mean to say it, but they just pushed the wrong button. And then and before you know it, there you go. Yeah. So we all have to ask the Lord for forgiveness. And then not only what we say, but what we think.
Yeah.
Now that's the struggle right there. If you could just keep your mind right and think the right thing, you know, at the right time, at all times. And we don't always do that. So we have to ask God to forgive us. But he prayed for himself and he prayed for his people. You see, we have to pray for our children. And our children's children. And our neighbors' children. We have to pray for one another. I was listening to Brother Reed as he prayed this morning. You know, we have a serious problem. And the problem has started and begun in the home. Now, you can't tell me how a school child can get a gun and put it in their book bag and get it out the house and intelligently shoot the gun when they get to school. There must be some training. Some know-how. In order to do that efficiently. And to not miss. So, it means that somebody in that house took that child out somewhere and showed him how to shoot that gun. Do you hear me? Now, listen.
You're right.
I can cook a little bit, but I cannot cook a cake. But you just don't just jump up and just cook a cake overnight. There must be some training or something that has to go on before you can do it efficiently. So the problem lies with the parent. The parent is not living up to their responsibility. Children don't hate because they hate. They hate because they are taught to hate. Do y'all hear? Y'all not expecting this kind of sermon today, are you? Children hate because they are taught to hate. They're taught to hate. You see, whatever they mimic, whatever they see and whatever they hear. If they hear mama or daddy use the N-word, they use it. Do you hear me? So what I am saying is, we are responsible. We are responsible. He prayed. He exercised penance. He exercised perseverance. And then he reminded God of his promises. He reminded God of his promises. That's verses 8 through 10. He reminded God, you redeemed these people. These are your people. And they are embarrassed by what has happened. And if they are embarrassed, you are embarrassed. So your name is on the line. What are you going to do about it? When we pray, we are to remind God of what he said. You said, I I would be the head and not the tail. You said, asking it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. I'm asking, I'm seeking, I'm knocking. You said, by your stripes I am healed. You said, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You've got to remind God of what he said. It's not that God has amnesia. He does not have amnesia. He knows what he said, but he wants you and I to remind him of what he said. I'm almost finished now. You got to remind him. It's in his prayer. He reminded God, these are your people. You redeemed them. They are in a bad shape. What are you going to do? Oh, yes. He said here, Psalm 138 and 2 said, I will worship toward your holy temple. You see, the Jewish man in Babylon, you know, they had no concept, you know, that God was omnipresent. He was everywhere. See, they didn't understand a God that was everywhere. They thought that when they left Jerusalem, they left God in Jerusalem. And whenever they prayed, they would turn toward Jerusalem. But they don't know like we know that God is everywhere. At the same time, he's God. I wish I had some help. Yeah, so the Bible says that he turned, and the psalmist said, I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth, for you have magnified your word above all of your name.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
In verse 11, it involves partnership. Everybody say partnership. You see, when you pray, Brother Reed, don't just pray by yourself. But you need to solicit and you need to register and enroll others to pray with you on the same accord. Y'all get calls me, look, I need you to pray for so-and-so, so-and-so. I got this going on, and I want you to be in prayer with me on this and that and whatever. That's partnership. That's partnership. And in other words, not only did he pray, but he had some other folk that were praying also. There's something powerful about partnership. And now you just can't access anybody to hook up with you now. Because you get the wrong somebody on the prayer line, they'll cancel everything you do. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? You can't just get anybody to pray. You got to know that they on one accord and they in agreement with you. And then it will come to pass. It's what's called synergy. Everybody say synergy. I'm almost through. Synergy. Now, anytime you see geese flying, they are flying in patterns, like a V. That's what you call synergy. And what that means is that the ones that are flying up front, they are the ones that's pulling the hardest. And the ones that have the back, they are flying off of, and they are gliding off of what the front are doing.
That's right.
But they don't always just keep on flying the ones up front. The ones up front, they switch and go to the back. And the ones at the back go to the front because the ones up front have gotten tired, and when they're at the back, they can rest. And they can glide while they're flying. All I'm saying to you is today that you and I ought to hook up with somebody and be in partnership. When you're in partnership, you can have some power from on high. Anybody in here ever call somebody, I need you to pray with me? I'm going in to see the doctor. And I want to be sure I have a good report. And I know that if you will get somebody that believes in prayer, you'll get a good report. Yeah, I had my daughter-in-law that had to go in surgery, and she reached out and she said, "Preacher, I need y'all to pray for me." And Carol and I, we got on the phone, and we put the speakerphone on, and I read some scriptures in her ears. And after I got through reading the word of the Lord, I got my mind right, and I start talking to the Lord. I can't tell you what I said, but the Spirit gave me the words to say. And after I got through praying, I knew that everything would be all right. And so she went on and had the operation. And after the operation and the recuperation began, lo and behold, whatever the problem was, it was solved by the grace of God. All I'm saying to you is you got to have vision if you want to change your condition. Isn't the Lord all right today? I don't know about you, but I'm believing God is going to change my situation. I'm believing God is going to come by my house. I'm believing God is going to come by your house. When he come by your house, he gonna bless you abundantly. I hear the Lord saying, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with winged eagles. They shall run and not get weary. They shall walk and not faint. Anybody in here ready to fly with the Lord? Anybody in here ready to walk with God? I don't know about you, but I'm glad that I'm saved today. I say I'm glad that I'm saved today. If you read the end of the story, after Nehemiah got through praying, he appealed to the king, and the king gave him everything that he needed. Isn't the Lord all right? And he went to Jerusalem with a large entourage and had secret service. He had the king's credit card. Isn't the Lord all right? He had letters of authority, and he called the people together one by one. But I'll tell you what he did. He didn't tell everybody all at once, but he went out at night and surveyed the wall. And after he surveyed the wall, he told the people what the plan was. And he put the walls back in 52 days. Isn't the Lord all right? When you stand with the Lord, he'll work it out for you. Won't he do it? Yeah, he'll work it out for you. Is he working it out for you? I'm believing he's working it out for me. Ain't it all right? Well, he was on that wall. They told him to come down. But I hear Nehemiah saying, I'm doing a great work, and I can't come down. I'm so glad that Jesus Christ kept hanging on the wall of Calvary. So glad kept on dying and hanging on that cross. Didn't he do it? Yeah, yeah. So glad that he died for my sin and he died for your sin. Didn't he do it? Treat me good like a good God should. Ain't it all right? I know that I've been changed. The angels in heaven done signed my name. Ain't it all right? Yeah, yeah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Praise your name. In the morning, I'm gonna praise your name. At night, I'm gonna praise your name. When I don't have any money, I'm gonna praise your name. When the devil get after me, I'm gonna praise your name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Yes, yes. Oh, yeah. Vision. Help wanting. People of vision. Are you a person of vision? Do you see what God sees? Do you see the possibility? Do you see the potential? It can be done. It will be done. If you pray and seek God, he will provide everything that you need to make it come to pass. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's stand on our feet.
We have heard the joyful sound, y'all. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land that the King is born again. There's a song I once commanded. Hallelujah, Jesus saves. Have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves. Jesus saves.
Thank you.
Quick announcement. All choir members, we will have rehearsal Wednesday night, 6 o'clock. Wednesday night, 6 o'clock.